Hello and welcome back to Proactive New York. Joining me today is Andrew Chanin, CEO at Procure Holdings. Alongside him is Hector McNeil, co-CEO at HANetf. It's great to have you both. How are you today?
Great and thrilled to be here.
Yeah, same here. Nice to see you again.
Great to have you here. Andrew, we're going to kick it off with you. HANetf, together with Procure Holdings, has launched a new ETF on the London Stock Exchange called Procure Space ETF under the ticker YODA, which is one of the best tickers I've seen thus far. So Andrew, maybe you could kick us off with talking a bit about the space industry and why investors should be attracted to it.
So we think the space industry is an extremely exciting industry, but one that is critically important. And many people don't necessarily realize how important space is in our everyday lives. Whether you're an individual, a company, a government, a military, space is the backbone for so much of what we do. And right now we're seeing some incredible changes across the space industry, especially from the commercialization standpoint. So in the early days of the space industry, it was more so almost a passion project where it was, let's get to the moon first. Let's send someone into space first, and really a national pride kind of mission. But over the years, we've noticed that the space industry has grown tremendously as well as the many different commercial applications. So think communications, broadband, internet. This interview today would not be happening without space. And so as we see many technological changes, increased government budgets towards space, more missions, and really what space can do for companies to enter this industry, we're very excited by the potential opportunities for this industry.
And you've already launched a similar ETF here in the US under the ticker UFO. So tell me a bit about that one and how that's performed so far.
So we've been thrilled to have the first pure play space ETF in the United States under UFO. There are roughly over 30 companies from around the world specializing in all different areas of the space economy. And launching this product in 2019, we actually have seen a really strong start to 2021, where our assets under management have increased by almost $100 million just in 2021 alone. But we've seen a tremendous amount of interest for space investment, coming from all different areas, whether private investment in space, public investment, SPACs. And so it's been something that we've seen a tremendous amount of that's really just started to pick up recently. And some of that could be from the media attention, but certainly it's very difficult to miss all the activities that are now occurring as they are starting to get a lot more attention. And as we see a ramp up in military spending and defense and see how space is really not just something that's nice to have, but as a truly essential part of our everyday economy, I think it's something that will continue to see more eyeballs come to the space industry and hopefully get a true understanding of what space is and where it's going.
Yeah, definitely. The new launch, the new ETF here that is to be launched in London is focused on the space index. So talk us through what that means.
So Procure Holdings works with SNEP. They have actually licensed to us various space indexes and IP. And what they did was they actually worked with a former director of the Space Foundation to help define and build out what a space industry is. Because to us, it was extremely important that if someone is going to be making an index that's supposed to be representative of space, that it truly actually does find out what companies are in space, how they're making their revenues, and if they truly are a space company. So they do a tremendous amount of research to dig through the no pun intended, the space universe of companies, looking for large publicly traded pure play companies. By pure play, means that they're looking for roughly 80% of the weight of the index to be focused on companies deriving at least a majority of their revenues from space. So there you'll find companies like satellite operators and manufacturers, launch companies, companies that are dependent upon space-based systems. So if you think about things like GPS technology, so your Garmins of the world, as well as some of your satellite radio, TV, internet types of companies. So many companies out there that are using space to generate revenues. There are some that have very kind of tangential focuses on space, but this is actually looking at companies deriving a large majority of their revenues from space, and then also realizing that there are some very large diversified players think your aerospace and defense names. They also thought it was important to have room for some of those types of companies in the fund because they do play major roles in the space industry. So up to 20% of the S network underlying space index can be in these more diversified space companies, but they truly are large players. So they do have certain minimum requirements where it's either $500 million in annual revenues from space or still over 20% of their revenues from space, but less than 50%. So you'll see some of your more diversified aerospace and defense names also finding their way into their indexes.
Thanks very much, Andrew. Now turning to you, Hector, can you maybe talk us through why Han ETF decided to get involved in the space industry and why launch this ETF now?
Well, I think if you look at the short history of Han, you know, a little over 2.5 years, we've sort of been pioneers for the broader thematic investment themes. You know, we were the first in Europe to come out with a cloud ETF, first to come out with e-commerce related ETFs as well. You know, and what struck us was when Andrew and his colleagues came out with the UFO product in the US was this, you know, this was a true game changer for us. We felt it was right up our street. We love ETFs with stories. You know, as you mentioned, even with the ticker YODA, you know, it's caused so much press just from having that. You know, it's every schoolboy and schoolgirl's fantasy, really, to see that. And, you know, may the force be with you, Christine. So certainly, we think it's, got a fantastic, immediate impact. But also what I really love about thematic ETFs is where you know that the industry is just going to spurn out new companies left, right and centre. And OK, the index is 30 stocks now. But, if you take something like EMQQ, the e-commerce ETF we had, it literally adds 10 new stocks every rebalance because it's a sector that's, you know, got lots of companies in the venture capital and private equity arena, you know, and is waiting for these companies to come to market. And what I think is really interesting as well, you know, just from an anecdotal perspective is you look around the world and think, you know, 30 years ago, how many countries could put a satellite into space and how big would that satellite be? You know, the size of a bus and, just a handful. And now you've probably got, 10s, 20s, 30s of countries that can put satellites into space, you know, and a satellite can be absolutely tiny. So, you know, it's a democratization of that industry. Then you also look at all the entrepreneurs, you know, like Musk and Branson and all these guys, you know, who are moving to see the potential of these industries. And these guys rarely get it wrong. You know, I mean, and they're pushing the boundaries, you know, quite literally with this. And, space travel is not too far away for, maybe not for the average person, but for certainly a good enough amount of people to make it interesting. So we think that ETFs are a fantastic democratic medium, you know, to give, all investors from small to large an ability to participate in these themes. You know, when you take YODA, for example, it's around about £7 a share. You can buy it on any of the execution-only brokers like Hargreaves Lansdown or AJ Bell or whatever. You know, I always say it's the first time, you know, my mum in Middlesbrough can now own part of the space race. So, that to me is pure democracy. And that's why it's really exciting to bring something like YODA to the market, really.
And do you think that European investors have an appetite for the space industry?
Oh, yeah, no doubt. I mean, I've seen on just the message boards over the past couple of weeks, stock requests. For both the US and the European, unfortunately, with the regulations like MiFID II, it's pretty hard for European investors now to buy US ETFs. You know, and I think Andrew would agree with this. If you have a global theme that global investors want to get access to, you pretty much need the 40 Act and the UCITS sitting side by side, and then you pretty much look after not just European investors but also Latin American and Asian as well. So I definitely think a lot of people are looking at this and. There's been some larger sort of active managers who've been getting into this space. You know, I think have been pretty much criticized as well because they've been pretty laissez-faire with how they define space, you know, with using stocks like Netflix in their holdings, you know, and I think to have a more pure play expert driven scenario is pretty great. And one of the things we've been able to do as well is give it a local feel by getting the European Space Agency involved in some of our promotions. You know, they seem very happy to want to promote the industry as a growing industry in Europe, not just the US. So we've had those guys on a couple of webinars, and they tend to help us even more just spreading this word. So yeah, we think it's, you know, we think it really is, you know, right at the beginning of this fantastic industry, really.
Well, congrats again on this launch, pun intended. Hector, Andrew, thanks so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.